Good morning, and can I welcome you to the first meeting in session six of the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee. I am Alexander Stewart, MSP for Mid Scotland and Fife, and as I am the oldest member of the committee present, I have the pleasure in convening this meeting for the first two items of business. I would like to take this opportunity to welcome all members to the committee, and I look forward to working with you during this tenure. Before we move to the first item, I would remind all members present to switch mobile phones to silent. We have received apologies from Edward Mountain, MSP, for this meeting. Item one is declarations of interest. Each of us, if we have any declarations of interest to indicate to the committee, will do so, and I will go first. I have no declarations of interest that are relevant to this committee. And I will now go through the members alphabetically. First of all, Bob Dorris.
Thanks, Alexander. Likewise, I have no declarations of interest that are relevant to this committee.
Thank you, Bob. And now on to Paul McLennan.
Thank you, convener. I, like yourselves, have no declarations of interest relevant to this committee.
Thank you, Paul. And Martin Whitfield.
Again, thank you, Alexander. I have no declarations relevant to this committee.
Thank you. Item two on the agenda is the choice of the convener. The Parliament has agreed that only members in the Scottish Labour Party are eligible for nomination as convener of this committee. And it is my understanding that Martin Whitfield is the party's nominee. Do we agree that Martin Whitfield should be the convener of the committee?
Agreed.
Congratulations, Martin. You are now convener of this committee, and I hand over the rest of the meeting to you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Alexander, and thank you for opening the meeting, bringing not just your age to the chair, but also your vast experience of committees in the past. And I'd also like to take the opportunity to welcome all of the members new to the Parliament, like Paul and myself, and those with, shall we say, a few more years' experience. I think we'll be looking to you for your guidance on this. I would just like to say a few words before moving on to the next agenda item, and that is that this is, in my view, a very important and powerful committee with a huge responsibility both to the Parliament but also to the people of Scotland. And from the outset, I wish to put on public record my recognition of the lack of gender balance on this committee, and that this has occurred because of the process of creating the membership of this committee rather than the act or the intention of any of its members. I intend, with the permission of this committee, to write to both the Bureau, but also to raise this at the conveners group as a matter of urgency. The effect of the situation we find ourselves in may directly affect aspects of this committee's responsibility, particularly with regard to the Standing Orders, Rules 6.41B and D. I have every confidence in each of the members of this committee. However, I am concerned that in fulfilling the responsibilities of this committee, we will not be able to carry the confidence of those we serve, or indeed those who will seek to rely on this committee. I hope the members of this committee are in agreement with this action, and I'm happy to discuss it in more detail when we turn to our programme of work later. The next item that falls is agenda item three, which is the choice of a deputy convener. The Parliament has agreed that only members of the Scottish National Party are eligible for nomination as deputy convener of this committee. And so I open the committee to see whether or not there is a nomination for this role. And I understand, Paul, you may wish to say something.
Yeah, Chair, can I formally nominate Bob Dorris for the position of Vice Convener?
Do we agree that Bob Dorris should be our Deputy Convener?
Agreed.
Excellent. Congratulations, Bob. You certainly have experience dating all the way back to 2007 with committee experience from local government, subordinate legislation, fact, I think virtually all committees, but most importantly, from my point of view, also with the predecessor of this committee. So I'll be looking to you for advice, wisdom and support, but congratulations.
Thank you.
Do you want to say anything?
I wouldn't normally say something at this point, convener, but I think given the resonance of the initial comments you made as convener, it would be remiss of me not to reflect in what you've just said, Martin. Of course, we should be striving for gender balance on all committees, particularly this committee, given the types of issues we will be looking at, hopefully as a matter of course, proactively, as a committee, quite frankly. So I would like to show my support for the initial comments that you have made, but look forward to working collegiately with all committee members, irrespective of the lack of gender balance, which is deeply unfortunate, to make sure that we seek the views of the wider MSP membership and wider society, quite frankly, which is far more reflective of Scotland than the membership of this committee may actually reflect in practice at the moment.
Excellent, and absolutely, I agree with those views. Thank you, Bob. Our fourth item agenda today is in respect of the last item, item 7, and whether or not we're in agreement to take this in private. Just as a short explanation, there are a number of items that will come before this committee that it would be better to take in private so that full and frank discussion can take place. There's no intention to avoid any transparency towards our decisions or our opinions or views. It's just to allow full discussion to take place. In the current meeting, this last item is really about our programme for work going forward. So, can I ask whether any members have any comments before I invite us to take that last point in private? Don't see anyone wishing to speak, so do the members agree to take this last item in private?
Agreed.
Very grateful. Item 7 is the cross-party group agenda item, and this has come up because of the timing of when committees have been started and the desire for members and groups out with the Parliament to start cross-party groups. We've been asked to consider the rules on the membership and the registration of cross-party groups. This requires, as I say, our attention because of the time scale. The committee is being invited to consider and agree a general modification to Rule 6.8 of the Code of Conduct to allow cross-party groups which have at least one MSP member from the majority of parties represented on the Parliamentary Bureau. This is not a rule change, but an indication of how we would apply our ability to waive certain parts and regulations of it. In this case, we are carrying on with a process that my understanding is began with the previous committee, but because of the change of the structure of the parties on the Parliamentary Bureau, we would like to give an indication to CPGs that we would continue to allow them to be registered where they have at least one MSP member from the majority parties on the Bureau. Would anybody like to intimate something or comment on it? I'm not getting any indication of that. So, do the members agree to this general modification?
Agreed.
Excellent. I like committees that move this fast. Agenda item 6 is the legacy paper. This is a document that was prepared by the previous committee to show the work that they covered and give an indication of the areas that they felt we should look at going forward. Just before we look at the legacy paper, and I invite people to comment on it, I would like the permission of the committee to write to the Session 5 members, and in particular the convener, to thank them for their work, but also to thank them for this legacy paper, which encompasses a huge amount of work and certainly raises a number of significant questions that we'll look at going forward. Do I have the committee's agreement to do that?
Yes.
Thank you. I'll now open the floor for a discussion about the legacy paper. And I see Alexander would like to comment on an aspect of it. So over to you, Alexander.
Thank you, Kinnear. Can I first of all echo many of your comments about the legacy paper? This committee is vitally important to ensure that within the Parliament and outside in the general public and in Scotland as a whole, that we are seen as being and performing the roles and responsibilities we have. And having had the opportunity to be on this committee in the past and see what the legacy paper is suggesting, I very much concur with their approach in that it does go into specifics that may well require to be revisited, that may well require further development, and the whole process about how this takes place. You know, examples like members' work outside Parliament is vitally important that we get the scrutiny and the governance of our membership. The whole aspect of sexual harassment has been very high on the agenda within the Parliament, but also outside the Parliament, and that will have to be looked at. And also the whole idea of lobbying. These are three areas, Convener, that I think that we need to take a very firm stand on and develop as we progress as a committee to ensure that we have, as I say, the confidence of the Parliament and also the confidence of the community and Scotland as a whole. So I very much look forward to going through the legacy paper with members and then finalising and itemising what we think are priorities within our first year of committee and then progressing that as we go forward. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much for that contribution, Alexander. Would anyone else like to comment on anything? Bob?
Thank you very much, Convener. I think I would concur with what Alexander Stewart has said and would just draw members' attention to two aspects of the legacy paper. One, of course, is in sexual harassment and inappropriate behaviour contained within that legacy paper. It's clear and explicit that the Parliament should never be complacent in dealing with these matters and that we're urged to keep such matters under constant review, as we of course should. I'm also mindful of the comments you made, Convener, at the start of this meeting about the membership of this committee not being particularly reflective of Parliament as a whole. We have to be mindful of that. That doesn't mean we can't do our job, but that doesn't mean it should have to be this way, of course. So just put that on the record. And also the section on involving people in our work. But just because we're a small committee and it may seem some of it to be the nuts and bolts and mundane aspects of the Parliament, a bit dry, but vitally important, I should have to say, doesn't mean we shouldn't reach out and involve various stakeholders and individuals in our work. Of course, we should do it. I can see the last committee did that. So my thanks to them for putting that on the record. I suppose finally, I did say two, but I do see the section on the Parliament's practices and procedures. There's a real strength that we'll get new members on this committee, because I have been a member of the Scottish Parliament since 2007, and the Parliament has been engaged in parliamentary forum in recent years, and some of that's embedding in. It's also very good to have a fresh set of eyes on the workings of Parliament. So I suppose my call to fellow committee members who are new to the Parliament to look constructively, but also with a degree of scrutiny into the workings of the parliamentary process, because it's really, really important to have a kind of fresh look at these things with new members coming in who haven't been here for a period of time, who can get set in your ways if you're not careful. So I just wanted to put that on the record as well. But I look forward to working collegiately again, taking forward many of the issues raised in the legacy paper.
Thank you very much, Bob. Paul?
Thank you, Convener. Just to concur with the comments that have been made, and I think two in particular involving people in our work, I think is really important. You know, we need to reach out to as many people and make sure we're listening to all parts of society. And I think the other one that's not been mentioned so far is around about the issue of the Scottish elections, and that was mentioned in the legacy paper. And I think, you know, we all went into the election thinking turnout might have dropped, and we had the opposite effect. So it would be good to understand the reasons behind that. And again, obviously trying to encourage as big a turnout in future elections. So I think a little bit of work and investigation into that, I think, would be very helpful, and hopefully can continue that trend, you know, of increased turnout. So, but concurred with the statements, and really looking forward to working with the rest of the committee.
Thank you very much, Paul. And I absolutely agree with all of the statements that have been made. I hope that, in fact, I really genuinely envisage that this committee can work collegiately across what some people call political boundaries. I prefer the political spectrum, because I think we have a good balance of new members and experienced members. And we're also a group of people who, I think, to echo what you've said, Bob, genuinely want to involve other people in this work. We don't have the answers sitting in this committee, but this is a committee where people who feel they do have answers to problems with regard to procedure and other matters can come to us, and they will get a listening ear. Can I thank everyone as we move to the end of this public aspect of our meeting? And he's just going to check his notes. Can I move to close the public element of this meeting, to thank everybody who is on this committee and the clerks who support us behind the scenes, and look forward to meeting in September, and wish everyone a lovely recess.